Your Excellencies, our Royal Fathers, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, when I came up here, I introduced myself as a true son of the soil. However, I needed to remind our chairman that the Oba of Lagos was here because I live in Lagos. And I don't want my COO and entry permit revoked. Also, because I am married to someone, to my darling wife from Abeokuta, who's an Eba lady, I wish to also make amends and recognize the Alake of Eba land. You who came before, so, having taken care of my Ijebu soil, gone to Lagos, and also recognized the Alake, I think I can now go on and recognize the former Pro Chancellor of the Olabisi Arubanjo University, Dr. Shekun Oshin, who is here present. Please give him a round of applause. It is also important for me to recognize a former governor of this wonderful state, Ogun State. Apart from being a former governor, he is also the Aremo Awujale of Ijebula. Please welcome Chief Shekun Oshoba, here present. We thank you very much. I would also like to thank the chairman of this occasion, who seems to have done all the work for me. I was supposed to come up here and introduce the lecturer of the second annual lecture that we're here to listen to. But he came up here and introduced him, making my work much shorter. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, Your Excellencies and our Royal Fathers here present, this is the time we're waiting for. May I respectfully invite the occupier of the Professorial Chair in Governance, instituted by our KBC, of our Dr. Sikuru Kaiode Adetolo, CFRJP, of Baba II, Parliament Ruler, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Professor AYO, OLUKOTUN.
Excellency, Deputy Governor of the State, Your Imperial Majesty, and Donor of the Chair of the Season, Oba Dr. Kaiode Sikiru Adetolo, and shall we just say that I stand on the protocol that we established. The chairman, Emeritus Professor Anthony Shiwaju, has already given a foretaste of today's lecture. And went beyond that with the very touching erudition characteristic of him and his generation to flash possible areas that the chair can look at, even with respect to the topic of today. And I'd like to start by taking that in. He mentioned the importance of moral authority, especially as we stand before the paramount ruler of Ijebula, who, as Professor Shiwaju remarked, and very correctly, is himself an exemplar and challenged its monopoly of legitimacy becomes, if you like, trivial or no more to the point. It monopolizes, the state monopolizes force. But once the state loses moral authority, it can be challenged, which is why you have contrary forces, countervailing forces in society. So, Emeritus Professor, thank you very much for that extension of today's meeting. As Professor Ashiwaju mentioned, this is the second in a series of professorial lectures delivered annually at the instance of the Oba Dr. Sikiru Kayode Adetona Professorial Chair. As you may recall, the series was inaugurated last year, that is after the formal functioning of the chair, by my delivery of governance and the media in an emergent democracy. This is an annual academic exercise, which by the grace of God will be held in perpetuity in what is perhaps the largest scholarly endowment in this country and beyond. As the chair matures, I venture to say that it will come to be seen as one of the important legacies of His Imperial Majesty of our Sir Dr. Sikiru Adetona, the originator and driving spirit of the endowment. It is important to recall, in the same connection, the sound management and time-tested procedures instituted by the Board of Trustees of the Chair under the moving spirit of KBSC and Barista Tunji Anolaja-san and the professionals of pedigree who constitute the board. As this is an academic chair, it is pertinent to mention the supportive role of the administration of Olabisi Olubanjo University under the able leadership of Professor Ganim Olatunji, who is working in the footsteps of his predecessor, Professor Saburi Adesina. I've also mentioned Professor Ebu Oduwole, Deputy Vice Chancellor, and other members of the administration, the Dean of my faculty, Professor Ademiluyi, the Head of Political Science, Dr. Salami, and their cognate opposite numbers in the Faculty of Administration and Management, Professor Shoye and Dr. Ahia. I can see in the room some scholars and senior citizens who have come in solidarity. I can see somewhere there the Amazin, Dr. Tokumbo Aulo Odosumu, who is very much an incarnation of the great AYO, Professor T.G. Ayo, Vice Chancellor of KM University, my colleagues from the OAU. I can see some of them in the room. I'd like to thank you all for coming. Of course, my beautiful wife is here, Stella. Thank you very much. Being the chair of governance, I've chosen to situate this lecture as I did last year under the rubric of governance in the context of civil society and its role and impact in Nigeria's democracy. I say that I began drawn to governance and democratization in the mid-1990s when I participated in the Obafemi Awolowo University / University of Florida Gainesville International Project on Governance and Democratization funded by USAID and the Canadian Endowment. We held an international seminar in Arusha, Tanzania in 1996, which enabled intense scholarly interaction around the concept of governance in Africa. We were held on by the stimulus of Professors Goran Hagen of the University of Florida, the late Kenyan scholar, Professor Okoth-Ogenio, Professor S.S. Mushi of the University of Dar es Salaam, and Nigeria's professors Aki Mabogunje, who is here with us, and Dele Olon. We wrestled with the concept of governance and its application to African politics. I remember that even in those years, Professor Mabogunje was held in awe and reverence. And of course, as people here will know, he's going to add to his already star-studded profile the equivalent of a Nobel Prize in geography. We are very proud of you, sir. I have reasons to believe that the book publication, African Perspectives on Governance, is an interesting document which spoke to the complexities and various dimensions of the project. I mentioned that my perspective was shaped by the University of Sussex Ford Foundation Governance Project, in which I participated as a researcher to immense benefit in clarifying my evolving thoughts on the subject. I say too that my academic research and role as public intellectual, I'm amused to see that I'm known more as the Friday columnist or coach than I'm known as an academic. Where I wear dual hats in that respect. In my public writings, I have focused on governance reforms with respect to deepening democracy, creating pro-people regimes that measure on accountability, rule of law, human rights, and other indices of good governance. As Joseph informs, Professor Joseph, governance as distinct from government or politics focuses on not just public institutions, but civil society, as well as actors and institutions that are non-state. Civil society is crucial to the establishment of good governance to the extent that it invokes state society regulations, legitimacy issues, how policies are framed and implemented, and how consensus and concept are brought about. Civil society, even though it mirrors the decay in the state, provides a counter narrative to the failure of the Nigerian state to operate a minimal social contract between it and the people. It is obvious those who are born in the last 20, 25 years never saw a functioning Nigerian state. They never saw a state that provided like a fire welfare benefits. So no longer at the first opportunity they want to do an anti. Our civil society is considered magnificent by many observers, although less so than its heroic undertakings in checkmating military rule in the 1980s and 1990s. I now provide what I call an overview of the issues. Civil society. I will take up or give a flavor, since this is not, since it's time and gown, I will give a flavor of this dispute in the next section of the paper. But broadly conceived, as the chairman also adumbrated, and also the vice chancellor, as the non-governmental sector, or the space between the family and the state, there is no doubt that it played a landmark role in Nigerian political history. Although many donor funded really under the whiplash of structural adjustment, human rights violations, and the postponement and later annulment of the rights of Nigerians to elect their leaders. I mentioned that one of the most auspicious encounters between state and society was the formation of NADECO. Including a pirate radio Gujarat to tackle the military government of General Swami Abacha. I remember when I was doing research on some of these roles, some of the actors were not willing to talk. They said, "Look, Prof, the country is not healed. This thing can't happen again. The country is not healed. So, we are still waiting for the healing of the country." So there is a reason about placing some of these counter-hegemonic struggles. Because who knows if they will still not be needed in one way or another. I mentioned the roles of professional associations such as ASU, which contributed in no small way to delegitimizing military rule, and several others. And I say that one of the questions frequently asked in the wake of Nigeria's transition to democracy is whether civil society has gone to sleep or has lost its bravado and patriotic fervor which it demonstrated under the military. I raise this question in the light of the fact well known that many star citizens and actors have been incorporated or co-opted into the elite sports sharing arithmetic that we have in Nigeria. While several others are in the interlacustra between politics and civil agitation, to move back and forth. But apart from these, there are NGOs that double as the political arm of parties and governmental organizations. An aspect of this is what Professor Obadari has referred to as the manufacturing of civil society. What he means by that is that the state also manufactures its own civil society. So you have a phantom civil society under the aegis of the state, and you have an authentic civil society, if you like the word, that has evolved from societal struggles. Obadari was referring to the mushrooming of several government-funded, ostensible civil society actors who are working in tandem with the state apparatus. Of course, this phenomenon has been there with us, and even today is still very much with us. We must not exaggerate the point, for in a democracy or semi-democracy, as is frequently called, the existence of representative institutions, such as the legislature, as well as the activities of political parties, tend to take the shine of civil activity. That said, it must be factored that democracy has not brought change to Nigeria. In fact, I remember Professor Hungary's article, which he called Transition Without Change. Sadly, governance remains shallow, disconnected from the people, reprobate, seen as a self-investment, and is symptomized by sham elections in which people are voting without choosing. Indeed, OLUKOTUN 2017 has spoken of a governance crisis characterized by dysfunctional government, widespread insecurity of life and property, collapsing infrastructure, and of public services, dysfunctional educational system, and almost fictional medical and healthcare facilities. I don't know about you, but in my generation, all my degrees are from the University of Ife, Bachelor's, Master's, PhD. But the point is, when I attended the University of Ife as an undergraduate, that degree was equivalent to a degree at the University of Manchester in England. But as parents or students, we know what the story has become today. So there's a governance crisis. Nigeria's degrees have become almost a mockery in the Committee of Nations. We can update OLUKOTUN's list by referring to recent revelations of outrageous salaries and emoluments paid to members of the National Assembly. Not my is barely out of recession. There's no way way we still don't need Kadesi's moral authority. I tell you. There's also the challenge to solve it posed by the Boko Haram insurgency, whose alleged defeat appears to be no more than a rhetorical claim, and the recent upsurge of atrocity killings by bandits believed to be Fulani headsmen. So, if there was a time when civil society should come into its own to ameliorate the crisis of governance, it must be now. Things are not working. To be sure, we have had civil society protests, such as those organized by the Safe Nigeria Group, leading to the so-called doctrine of necessity, under which the then Vice President was confirmed in the position of acting president. That was in 2009. The Occupy Nigeria movement of 2012, which forced a downward review of a wanton hike in the price of petroleum products, and the weekly organized our Mumu Don Do, led by entertainer and social activist Charles Okuta, aka Charlie. Less dramatic here, there was a sustained campaign for the Freedom of Information Act over a 12-year period, spearheaded by the media rights agenda, leading to the passage of the Freedom of Information Bill in 2011. On balance, however, and related to the candor of the lecture, it is true to say that we are not witnessing thus far the kind of civil society activity that can challenge state impunity, or that can genuinely restrain predatory behavior on the part of state officials. You know, you remember the British philosopher who said that in between elections, the British people are slaves. In between elections. Well, that was 2 centuries back. They are no longer slaves now, in between elections. I'm afraid the Nigerian electorate are slaves in between elections. In other words, why some civil society organizations, such as Electoral Reform Network, Budget, the DA Foundation, the Social Economic Rights and Accountability Project, have been able to bring about marginal advances in policy reforms or in budget monitoring, much of this are limited and confined to a few NGOs. Overall, most NGOs are limited in capacity, funding, resource profile, and are in many cases one man or one family organizations, which bring to life which come to life when a new tranche of donor funding has been received. Hence, the real locus of civil society activity has been with spontaneous protest movements led by charismatic leaders such as Tunde Bakare, Femi Falana, Wole Soyinka, Joe Odumake, some of whom are also active in the political arena. To end this session, it is important not to glamorize civil society, considering that it is too often as factionalized as the political public sphere, ethnic and religious conflicts, partisanship, corruption, cooptation by state actors, and the locational concentration of civil society activities in the Southwest are all factors that come into play. Indeed, the visibility of ethnic associations such as Afenifere, Ohanese Ndibu, Arewa Consultative Forum suggests that a divided nation may have merely reproduced a divided civil society. For example, it is doubtful if the endorsement of President Muhammadu Buhari's second term by the coalition of civil society organizations for good governance and democracy is representative enough of the opinion of civil society organizations across the country. At any rate, where else do you find civil society organizations endorsing somebody ahead of his saying that he wanted to contest elections? This endorsement, so-called, came before President Buhari himself said that he would throw his hat into the ring. So it was very premature. And how do civil society organizations who are not state funded, if they are not, come up to say that we are endorsing a candidate ahead of the primaries? I think it's anomalous. Additionally, civil society, despite its promise and appeal, is caught in several contradictions, which include poor governance structures, the presence of phantom boards, careerism, and unethical government. I owe this to one of the civil society leaders, Dr. Obuzo. I'm going to skip my conceptual session, since this is not regarding the former academics. The chairman has already alluded to it. But I will just take something from it, namely the concept of governance, because this is a governance chair, and I think it's important to speak to that. I quote Professor Goran Haydn, who defines governance as how power is being exercised and with what result, as the conscious management of regime structures with a view to enhancing the legitimacy of the public realm. I mentioned that governance can be seen as a tripod, and I owe this to Professor Adeye, who said that, and I agree with him, that governance can be conceived as structure, that is, the architecture of formal and informal institutions. Governance can be seen as process, dealing with the ebbs and flows of policy making. And finally, governance can be seen as strategy, dealing with the efforts of actors to widen or shape choices and preferences. These three dimensions are interesting to us as we look at the concept of governance. A related point is the expression good governance, which denotes an ensemble of interventions to enhance accountability, transparency, rule of law, human rights, and poverty alleviation. I'm not going to go into a long argument about the ideological orientation and intellectual origin civil society. There's a long argument about this. The chairman has already talked about this. I don't want to do this. We can leave this for our graduate classes. So, we do not need to be detained by this, especially if we draw a distinction between the economy
of this lecture. Is Nigerian civil society dead?
or in stupor. I bring up several activities of CSOs in Nigeria which connote policy making and policy implementation. Because, as I say, the main body of this lecture is to answer that question. You will remember that Professor Isesage, Special Advisor to the President on Anti-Corruption, made a comment a few months back that Nigerian civil society is dead. That's what he said. And are trying to interrogate this assertion. Is it dead? Or merely in slumber? Can it be waking up? Or is it dead and buried? So, the data that I have amassed here is to answer that question. And I give various examples in this paper of civil society action behind the curtain, behind the trenches in which they try to align themselves with policy making. An example is that you will be surprised if you don't already know that the famous looters list that was published by the federal government was in fact the result of a court action instituted by one of our civil societies. Although government did it in its own way, not fully obeying the court order. But it is interesting to note that that came as a consequence of the court action instituted by civil society. In my penultimate session, I actually draw examples of civil society activity, one of them behind the lines, the other overt. The one behind the lines is the passing of the Freedom of Information Bill by the Nigerian Senate after, guess, a 12-year struggle. It took 12 years for civil society led by media rights agenda to get passed as law a Freedom of Information Bill. I can also tell you that what the law has given with the right hand is being taken by the left, because government officials in many cases have a culture of secrecy. They are not eager to release information, and civil society in some cases and freely is trying to test the limits of that game. So, the point is that even after a 12-year struggle, we are still not out of the woods. Permit me to skip this another section of my paper and go on to what I call a roadmap for reform and reinvention of civil society. I say that a debate broke out recently in the wake of a published article by a Nigerian journalist, Godwin Oyachole, entitled "The Death of Nigeria's Civil Society." The article looked back nostalgically at the glorious days of anti-dictatorship struggles of civil society groups and concluded that, quote, although there are genuine civil society organizations out there, one can hardly see the wood for the trees anymore. It was therefore not a surprise that Professor Isesage, chair of the Presidential Advisory Committee Against Corruption, publicly lamented the death of civil society in Nigeria, a painful fact long acknowledged by honest observers of unfolding events in the country, unquote. This paper has shown that that position may have been overstated. Indeed, AYO, a human rights lawyer and former president Civil Liberties Organization, assisted in putting a perspective on the issues in her reply to the journalist. To quote Obe, life cannot be a perpetual Arab Spring. But if a journalist only wants to cover Arab Spring type events, then obviously he will think that Nigerian civil society is dead. He won't see those of us doing the hard, unglamorous work of dealing with the knots and bolts of democracy. So that's the counter argument. Is it an excuse or a genuine argument? Now, I say, true enough, and as this paper has shown, there are several CSOs quietly extending the frontiers of democracy away from sizzling headlines. There are also others, as our case studies, which I cannot read, demonstrate, it's in the paper, which are still very much in the trenches on behalf of governance reforms. However, it would be ideal to wave aside the perception that civil society is dead. What is often meant by this is that we are not seeing the kind of seminal encounters and confrontations that were so much a feature of our national life in the 80s and 90s. This does not, however, mean that civil society is not out there canvassing changes and reforms. What I gather that the critics are saying is that they would like to see a rejuvenation of the energy and if need be, combativeness that once characterized civil society engagement. For obviously, and as I have demonstrated, Nigeria's governance crisis has gotten from bad to worse, with the Buhari government promising change, but ending up being swallowed up by the enormity of the problems. What a former minister called reforming the unreformable. So, we need to reinvent civil society because the state can be likened to somebody who attempts a miracle crusade and somebody fell down, they are dead, and nothing happened. No? Nothing happened. And it's a miracle crusade. So, if civil society is the answer, in some sense, to our governance problems, it must reinvent, it must bring back the lost stamina, the lost moral authority, as Ashland has called it, in order to tackle and to show a roadmap out of the woods in which we are at the moment. I mentioned, therefore, that civil society activists should begin to take on such issues like a Nigerian senator taking home 13 million naira monthly, 13 million naira monthly, each of them, as overheads that on the other payments below the table. But the one that was revealed is as overheads 13 million naira per month. is this not an issue for civil society attention? Indeed, by now, and in the last section of this paper, indeed, by now, civil society organizations ought to have developed facilities for entering the public space to contest such issues and to mobilize opinion without resorting to violence. And I go on to read my concluding page, which simply asks a question. I say, is civil society dead? I don't think so, but it is obviously in a state of stupor and requires reawakening. I thank you for listening.